Üçüncü sektörün değerli temsilcileri, değerli konuklarımız, basın mensubu arkadaşlarım, artık geleneksel hale gelen Sabancı Vakfı'nın düzenlediği 7. filantropi seminerine hepiniz hoş geldiniz ve burada bir alkış daha lütfen. Seminerimizde bu yıl toplumsal gelişmede fark yaratan iki lideri ağırlıyoruz. Onlar sosyal değişimin cesur ve azimli iki güçlü lideri. Filantropi alanında imkansızı mümkün kılan iki liderden bahsediyorum. Hollanda Prensesi Mabel van Oranje ve alkış. Ve Zimbabwe'de Tinogona Vakfı'nın kurucusu Dr. Tererai Trent. Kendilerine hoş geldiniz diyoruz tekrar ve hayırseverlik alanında paylaşacakları hikayelerin hepimize ilham vereceğine inanıyorum. İmkansızı Zorlamak isimli seminerimize başlamadan önce kısaca akışımız hakkında sizlere bilgi vereyim. Açılışımızı sevgili Sabancı Vakfı Genel Müdürü Zerrin Koyunsağ'ın sizlere iletecek Güler Sabancı adına ve sonrasında üçümüz konuklarımızı takdim edeceğiz tabii ki. Mabel van Oranje ve Tererai Trent'in sizlere hitap edeceğini söyleyeyim. Ve sonrasında bu arkamda gördüğünüz küçük hazırlanmış sohbet bölümüne geçeceğiz. Ve ben onlara soru soracağım. Onlar kendileri hakkında biraz daha bilgi verecekler. Ve sonra da eğer sizlerin sorusu varsa soru cevap bölümümüze geçeceğiz. Onun için lütfen eğer sorularınız varsa şimdiden hazırlayınız. Son bölümümüzde sizlerden soru alacağız çünkü. Şimdi seminerimizin açılış konuşmasını yapmak üzere Sabancı Vakfı Genel Müdürü Sayın Zerrin Koyunsağ'ı kürsüye davet ediyorum alkışlarınızla.
Evet, günaydın. Aslında açılış konuşmasını Güler Hanım yapacaktı. Maalesef iki gündür çok ağır bir grip geçiriyor. İki gündür konuşuyoruz. Sabahleyin de konuştu. Ben hazırlıklarımı yapıyorum, geleceğim dedi ama maalesef gelemedi. Benden rica etti, benim konuşmamı, sen mesajımı ilet dedi. Onun için ben sizlere ileteceğim. Ama öncelikle bugünkü temamıza çok uygun bir gündeyiz. İmkansız zorla bak, sizler de hepiniz imkansız zorlayıp buraya geldiniz. Öncelikle çok teşekkür ederiz, hoş geldiniz. Evet, Güler Hanım mesajını okumak istiyorum. Değerli vakıf ve sivil toplum kuruluşlarının temsilcileri, değerli konuşmacılarımız, Hollanda Prensesi Mabel van Oranje ve Dr. Tererai Trent, değerli basın mensupları, Sabancı Center'a ve seminerimize hoş geldiniz. Bugün Sabancı Vakfı Filantropi Seminerimizin, hayırseverlik seminerimizin 7.'sini düzenliyoruz. 2 gün önce 10 Aralık'ta Dünya İnsan Hakları Günü'nü kutladık. Seminerimizi her yıl bugün de içine alan haftada yapmaya özen gösteriyoruz. Çünkü insan hakları ile hayırseverlik arasında çok kuvvetli bir bağ var. İnsan hakları, hayır işleriyle uğraşan vakıflar, dernekler veya bireyler için vazgeçilemez bir kavram. İnsan haklarının özü, insanla ilgili hiçbir şeye kayıtsız kalmamaktır. Biz Sabancı Vakfı olarak insana dair çalışmalar yürüten dünyadaki filantropi sektörünü yakından takip etmeye çalışıyoruz. Konularında uzman isimlerden dinlediğimiz farklı görüşler ve yeni yaklaşımlar bize yeni perspektifler kazandırıyor. Bu yıl seminerimizin adını imkansız zorlamak olarak belirledik. Çünkü sosyal değişim için imkansız zorlamanın gerekli olduğuna inanıyoruz. Bazıları bireysel çabalarıyla kendi hayatındaki imkansızlıkları zorlayarak değişimi yaratıyor. Bazıları da sahip olduğu olanaklarla geniş kitleleri örgütleyerek çözülmesi imkansız gibi görünen toplumsal sorunlarla mücadele ediyor. Bu iki farklı modeli göreceğiz bugün. Birbirini tamamlayan iki farklı model. İlk konuğumuz çocuk evlilikleri konusunda dünya çapında çalışmaları örgütleyen, bizim de üyesi olduğumuz Uluslararası Çocuk Yaşta Evlilikleri Önleme Platformu'nun başkanı sevgili Mabel van Oranje. Diğer konuğumuz çok zor şartlar altında okumayı başaran, Afrika'dan Amerika'ya uzanan hayat hikayesiyle tüm dünya kadınlarına örnek olan Zimbabwe'de kurduğu vakıf ile eğitimde fırsat eşitliği için çalışan, okullar yaptıran sevgili Tererai Trent. Birazdan bizlerle kız çocuklarının insan haklarının iyileştirilmesinden eğitimde fırsat eşitliğine kadar uzanan insana dokunan deneyimlerini paylaşacaklar. Onlardan toplumsal gelişme adına verdikleri mücadeleleri dinleyeceğiz. Bugün imkansız zorlayan liderler bize ışık tutacak, ilham verecek. Her iki konuşmacımızın hikayesi, dünyanın lider kadınlara ne kadar ihtiyacı olduğunu bizlere bir kez daha hatırlatacak. Sevgili Mabel ve sevgili Tereraye aramızda oldukları için, davetimizi kabul edip geldikleri için hepiniz adına çok teşekkür ediyorum. Değerli misafirlerimiz, tüm dünyada kabul gören bir gerçeklik var ki, sosyal değişim için kadınların liderliği çok önemli. Son dönemde tüm yapılan araştırmalar bunu desteklemektedir. Çünkü değişim için gerekli olan bakış açısı, duyarlılık, yenilikçilik, sosyal sorumluluk bilinci, duygusal zeka kadınlarda çok daha güçlü. Toplumsal gelişme konusunda sürdürülebilir adımlar atılmasında kadın liderlerin kilit bir rolü var. Ancak her konuda olduğu gibi tek başlarına yapamazlar. Bu hep beraber yapılacak bir iş ama kadınların tetikleyici bir rolü olduğuna inanıyorum. Dolayısıyla kadınları ekonomi, siyaset ve sivil toplum üçgeninde güçlendirmemiz gerekiyor. Fırsat eşitliği sağlayarak aktif, üretken bireyler olmalarına destek vermemiz gerekiyor. Ve eğitim. Kadınların potansiyellerinin harekete geçirmesi için eğitim her şeyin ön koşuludur ve öncelikli insan hakkıdır. Bu kısmı iki kere okuyacağım çünkü Güler Hanım sabahleyin bu kısmı iki kere okumamı rica etti benden. Özellikle kız çocuklarının en azından 18 yaşına kadar, liseyi bitirene kadar okuması sağlanmalıdır. Bu en temel insan haklarıdır. Böylece onlara kendi geleceklerine dair sağlıklı kararları verebilecek olgunluğa erişme hakkını tanıyabiliriz. Sağlıklı tercihlerde bulunma hakkı, yetişkin olma hakkını tanıyabiliriz. Bir kere daha alıyorum bu kısmı. Özellikle kız çocuklarının en azından 18 yaşına kadar, liseyi bitirene kadar okuması sağlanmalıdır. Bu en temel insan hakkıdır. Böylece onlara kendi geleceklerine dair sağlıklı kararları verebilecek olgunluğa erişme hakkını tanıyabiliriz. Bizler de Sabancı Vakfı olarak kadınların ve kız çocuklarının eğitime ve toplumsal hayata daha aktif katılmalarını sağlamak için sağlıklı bir toplum yapısı inşa edebilmek için çalışmalar yürütüyoruz. Çalışmalarımızda insanların potansiyellerini kullanmaları için bir kapı açıyoruz. Bulundukları yerden daha yukarı çıkmaları için çabalıyoruz. Ülkemize kazandırdığımız 120'den fazla kalıcı eserin 81 tanesi doğrudan eğitimle ilgili. Okullar, öğrenci yurtları, kütüphaneler, öğretmen evleri ve tabii ki Sabancı Üniversitesi. Bu yıl Van'daki depremden sonra şehrin yeniden yapılanmasını esas alarak bir okulumuzu yeniden inşa ederek hizmete açtık. Mardin'de yaptırdığımız kız yurdunu bir ay içinde hizmete açıyoruz. Bugüne kadar üniversite öğrencilere sağladığımız bursların sayısı 40 bine yaklaştı. 100 bine aşkın ödülle gençlerimizin başarılarını teşvik ettik. Eğitime yönelik binaların, bursların yanı sıra desteklediğimiz sosyal projelerle de kadınların ve kız çocukların insan haklarını geliştirmeyi hedefliyoruz. Bakanlıklar ve Birleşmiş Milletler'in işbirliğiyle kadınların ekonomik ve toplumsal hayata güçlenmeleri için çalışıyoruz. Hibe programlarımızda kadınların toplumsal hayata katılımını hedefleyen projeleri destekliyoruz. Son yıllarda çocuk gelinler sorununun çözümünde aktif rol alıyoruz. Böyle önemli bir konuda, kamuoyunda ve medyada farkındalık oluşmasında katkımızın olması bizi mutlu ediyor. Bu saydıklarım toplumsal gelişme için Sabancı Vakfı olarak çözüm üretmeye çalıştığımız konular. Ancak unutmamalıyız ki dünyada da ülkemizde de çözüm bekleyen daha pek çok sorun var. Toplumsal sorunlar ne kadar büyük görünse de bazen tek başına verilen bir mücadele bile büyük bir fark yaratabiliyor. Bazen de sorunun büyüklüğü küresel boyuttaki çalışmaları örgütlemeyi gerektiriyor. Her ikisini de yapmak güç ama imkansız değil. İhtiyacımız olan şey ise köklü bir değişimi gerçekleştirebilecek, imkansızı kararlılıkla zorlayan ve hedefine ulaşan sosyal liderler. Bugün burada ağırladığımız konuklarımız, küresel ve yerel düzeyde çözülmesi imkansız gibi görünen sorunlara karşı verilen mücadelenin temsilcileri. İnanıyorum ki toplumsal gelişmede kararlı ve sabırlı olmak bizi başarıya götürecektir. Sabancı Vakfı olarak bugüne kadar Türkiye'nin dört bir yanında dokunduğumuz insanları, kadınları, gençleri, engellileri, kız çocuklarını gördükçe buna daha çok inanıyorum. Birazdan konuşmacılarımızdan imkansız zorlamanın toplumsal gelişmede yarattığı etkileri dinleyeceğiz. Unutmayalım ki artık yeni bir dünyadan söz ediyoruz. Bu yeni dünya küresel işbirliklerine, birlikte çözüm üretmeye çok daha yatkın. Dolayısıyla bugünkü konuklarımızın yaklaşımlarından ve deneyimlerinden hep birlikte önemli çıkarımlar elde edebileceğimizi umuyorum. Tekrar Sabancı Center'a geldiğiniz ve toplantımıza katıldığınız için hepinize çok teşekkür ediyorum. Güler Sabancı.
Teşekkür ederim.
Sayın Güler Sabancı'ya acil şifalar diliyoruz. Fakat sabahtan beri Zerrin Hanım'la konuşmalarına şahitlik ediyorum ve gerçekten önemli üzerinde durulmasını istediği konuyu ki az önce Zerrin Hanım da dile getirdi. Ben de bir kez daha sizlere aktarmak istiyorum. 18 yaşına kadar her kız çocuğunun eğitim hakkı temel hak ve özgürlüğüdür, öyle değil mi efendim? Katılıyorsunuz değil mi? Evet, çok teşekkür ediyoruz Sayın Koyunsağ'a. Şimdi de ilk olarak birinci konuşmacımızı sizlere tanıştırmak ve sahneye davet etmek istiyorum. Hollanda Prensesi Mabel van Oranje, çocuk yaşta evliliklere son vermek amacıyla kurulan küresel platform Girls Not Brides'ın başkanı. Avrupa Konseyi Dış İlişkiler Eş Kurucusu ve Başkanı. Açık Toplum Vakfı'nın uluslararası kurul üyesi olarak görev yapmaktadır. Mabel aynı zamanda sivil toplum sektöründe çalışmalar yürüten Crisis Action'ın yönetim kurulu, Global Witness'ın danışma kurulu ve The Elders'ın danışma meclisi üyesidir. Kendisi 2005 yılında Dünya Ekonomik Forumu tarafından genç küresel lider olarak seçilmiştir. Mabel van Oranje'yi alkışlarla sahneye davet etmek istiyorum.
Good morning. Thank you very much for these warm words of welcome, also the words, the very kind words of Güler Sabancı, who unfortunately cannot be here. Challenging the impossible. That is what we are talking about today. But my question is, what is impossible? If you had asked 30 years ago, if you had said, communism will come to an end, the Iron Curtain will come down, the wall of Berlin will fall, people would have declared that you were crazy. If you, at the time when Nelson Mandela, Madiba, was sitting on Robben Island, would have said that by the end of the 80s and the early 90s, there would be an end to apartheid, most people would probably have said, that's impossible. Or what about food binding in China, a harmful practice that took place for centuries and centuries, but that disappeared in one generation? Who would have thought that that could happen so quickly? Or think about the fact that there is an American black president nowadays. That was thought to be impossible for a long, long time. Now, I've been involved with a few things that people thought were impossible to change. For example, Montenegro, a small country in the Balkans, becoming independent. Or the creation of the International Criminal Court, which nowadays is in The Hague, and where those accused of the biggest human rights abuses stand trial. And one of the things that I've learned in seeing the impossible becoming possible is that you need a big vision of change, of what you want to achieve. And then the impossible will actually become possible. So today I would like to talk a little bit about an issue that is requiring an enormous vision of change to make the impossible possible. What I want to talk about is ending child marriage, which right now might still seem impossible. So let me tell you a little bit about what child marriage is. Child marriage is a harmful practice that is affecting girls and boys, mainly girls, but also in some places boys, under the age of 18. These girls are forced to get married with men who they not choose at a time that they do not choose. And what you often see, and these girls can be 15, 16 years of age, but they can also be as young as 11 or 12, and I must admit I have met on too many occasions girls who were as young as 6 or 7 or 8 years old when they got married. Now what happens is that when these girls get married, almost always their education ends. So if we want to keep every girl in school until the age of 18, actually child marriage is preventing that from happening. And that does not only have immediate implications for the girl, but it also has a long-term implication for those girls and their families, because it significantly reduces any earning power that they have for the rest of their lives. These girls also often enter in relationships where the husband is much older, and then therefore you often see that they will become victims of mental and or physical abuse and forced sexual relations. You know, we often say that marriage protects against infection with sexually transmittable diseases like HIV/AIDS. Well, in this case, that's often not happening, because the men, who are often older, have been around sexually before their marriage, and so they actually bring sexually transmittable diseases into the relationship. And then there are other reasons why child marriage is not a good thing. For example, maternal health. You often see that girls who marry young are forced to show their fertility by having babies at a very young age and having quite a few of them. Now, the reality is, think about it, a girl who's 13 years old, herself still a child, giving birth to a child. Physically, you can just picture that. It's not a surprise that a woman or a girl who's giving birth when she's 15 years or younger is 5 times more likely to die during childbirth than if she was 18 or older when she was delivering her first baby. And then once these child brides get babies, often you see that their children are more likely to die in the first year of their lives. In fact, a baby who's born to a mother who's younger than 18 is 60% more likely to die in the first year of life than if the mother is 18 or older. So altogether, child marriage is not just bad for the welfare and the well-being of these girls, but it is affecting the well-being of their families and their communities as well. Child marriage is often a driver of poverty. So child marriage is a human rights abuse, it's a form of violence, and it is a development issue. Now you might think, you know, that's all very nice, a Dutch princess standing there talking about this issue. Why should I care? Well, you know why you should care? Because these girls are invisible. But the fact that we don't know about them doesn't mean that it isn't important. And in numbers, we're talking about an enormous amount of numbers. Globally, 14 million girls get married every year. That means that every 2 seconds, a girl somewhere in the world got married before she was 18 years old. That was yet another girl getting married. Now you might think this is an issue that's far away, but let me tell you something. It's happening all over the world. Yes, it happens more in Africa and in South Asia than in other places, but it is happening everywhere. Even in the United Kingdom, where I currently live, it's happening among immigrant communities. And it's also happening across all religions. This is not a one religion issue. No, this is happening throughout religions. In fact, there are 51 countries in the world where 25% or more of the girls get married before they're 18. So let me give you a few facts and figures about Turkey. And the reality is that because this is an invisible problem, we don't know very well. There's a lack of data what's happening. But the latest estimate done by the United Nations is that 28% of all girls in Turkey marry before they're 18. A lot of it, and the reason why we don't know about it, is it because it happens through religious marriages, which are, as you might know, are not registered, which therefore means they're not legally recognized. So if girls who get married through religious marriages end up in situations where their husband dies or where, you know, they end up with a divorce, they have zero legal rights. And in Turkey, I was also looking at the figures, it happens more in rural communities, it happens more in the east of your country, but it is also happening in the west, including in cities like Istanbul. Now you might ask yourself, why is this happening? And I'm a mother of 2 young daughters. One is 7, one is 8 years old. And I think sometimes of the girls that I met who are the age of my daughters who got married. And I'm thinking, I cannot believe it that their parents married them off because they wanted to hurt their children. Because I'm convinced that all parents in the world want the best for their children. So how can it be that we end up with a paradox that where parents want the best for their children, where parents want to protect their families, they resort to doing something that is actually harmful for their daughters and harmful in the longer term for the community? Well, it seems that there are four main reasons. The first thing that's driving child marriage is gender inequality. Norms and expectations make that we think that girls can be treated differently than boys and that there's nothing wrong with marrying girls at a younger age. Secondly, there are economic reasons. For poor families, it might mean that marrying a girl off, it means one less mouth to feed, or in some cases where there's still a bride price to be paid, it means a little bit of income for the remainder of the family. A third reason relates to safety and family honor. A fear that girls might get sexually assaulted and that they would dishonor the family. However, while we think that maybe marriage might bring safety to the girls, we also know that in different ways, because of the health issues, the violent issues, marriages themselves are actually not safe places. And lastly, there is the issue of tradition, social norms, social pressure. Imagine that I live in a community and I have a 13-year-old daughter who the whole community thinks that should be married because in our community it's normal that we marry our girls at the age of 13. Now, I can potentially personally refuse to do that and I might think I don't want this. But if all of you think that this is normal and I don't do it, then either my daughter might never find a husband or you might think that I'm crazy. Now, many of you might think the same way that I'm thinking. You might think, I also don't want to marry my daughter at 13, and I also would rather not do it. But we don't know this from each other, and we're all afraid that we might be pushed out of the community. However, I'm a strong believer in what Graça Machel has said. Graça Machel is the widow of Nelson Mandela, and she's also one of the members of the elders who have taken on this issue of child marriage. And Graça Machel always says, traditions were made by men, so traditions can be changed by men. So what are we gonna do? How are we gonna make this problem that might sound slightly impossible to you now, how are we gonna make it possible to actually solve this? Well, let me bring the tough news first. There are no easy solutions. We need a holistic approach, and we need to work at a global level, at a national level, and at local level. Because ultimately, change needs to happen at the local level, within the communities. But that won't happen unless we create an environment nationally of laws and of policies where it becomes possible to create this change locally. And there, what we also need is globally much more attention to this issue. So the first thing I think that we need to do is we need to raise much more awareness that child marriage exists, that it is harmful, and that it should end. We need to make sure that we have laws that make it clear that girls and boys should not marry until 18. And, you know, in many places in the world there are laws, but they do not get implemented. So let's make sure that we start implementing them. We also should empower girls. We should give them information, we should give them life skills, we should find support groups for them, and we should give them education, which we were talking about a bit earlier. Very importantly, we need to change the attitudes of parents and communities. And we know that this can work. There are examples, not enough yet, but there are many examples that show that if you engage in a respectful way with a community, and that doesn't mean me walking in, telling people how to live their lives, because, you know, I'm an outsider, and I'll be accused of being a cultural imperialist who should mind her own business. But when you bring to communities people who they trust and start talking about the harmful implications of child marriage, the fact that, you know, the economic implications for the community, the health implications for the girl in the community, then you often see that village elders and religious leaders and other people who are like opinion formers in communities realize that it's not only against the best interest of the girl to continue child marriage, but it's actually against the interest of the community. And then they become willing to change, willing to change this practice. And lastly, we can provide economic support and incentives to keep girls out of marriage by keeping them, for example, in school. And of course, we should not forget that those girls who were already married at a young age deserve our support. Now, in order to create this wave of change that I think is necessary, to make this seemingly impossible task of any child marriage possible, let me share a few of what I think are factors of success, based on what I think whenever big change has happened in history, big or smaller change, what was necessary in order to do that. And I have four of them. The first one is to be pragmatic. We need to, whenever we try to create change, look at what are the real needs, the local needs on the ground. We need to learn from our successes, and if we fail, we should admit it, because there is no success without failure. And similarly, with what we learn while we're trying to implement programs, we should change our strategy if that's necessary. And I'm very encouraged that one of the grantees of the Sabanci Foundation, the Flying Broom organization, that they are actually now trying to learn much more about what is happening locally in towns and villages in Turkey about child marriage and how best to change it. So this pragmatism is crucial, I think. Secondly, I believe that if you want to create big change, you should realize that we can all make a difference, each and every one of us, but nobody can do it alone. So we have to work together. We have to bring our voices together so that they sound louder. And that's one of the reasons why we created Girls Not Brides, the global partnership to end child marriage. Because we realize now we are more than 300 NGOs from more than 50 countries. We're starting to be heard. The United Nations is listening to us. You do know the Human Rights Commission is listening to us. The African Union is starting to listen to us. Politicians are starting to listen. But it also means that we can learn from each other. The Flying Broom organization, which I referred to earlier, they traveled to India, to Bangladesh, to Niger, and to Nigeria with the help of the Sabanci Foundation to learn about what's working and not working. And you might think, like, but you know, what is there to learn in those places? They're so different. And yes, they are very different, but there are also similarities, and that can help to better understand what might work here in Turkey and the other way around. And you know, we ultimately have to unite all these change makers if we really want to see big change happen. But as I said, we can all make a difference, but we cannot do it alone. But I really hope that all of you will help, start helping to make a difference here. Thirdly, we need leadership. And you have leadership in formal shapes, politicians who take the lead, religious leaders who speak out against a practice like child marriage, a wonderful woman like Gular Sabanci taking the lead and speaking out on this, both nationally as well as globally. But we also need informal leadership. And I'm often very impressed with the informal leaders who are trying to create change. Teachers who are trying to protect girls from marriage. Girls who are trying to inform their peers that this is a bad practice and help them understand what they can do to stop it. Young boys who are actually trying to tell their parents that it is not good if their parents marry them to young girls. All these informal leaders, many of them we will never hear about, can play a crucial role. And my fourth factor of success, I would say, is patience. Real change, big change, does not happen overnight. It requires time and it requires determination to see the issue that you want to solve, to see it through. So if I may, being here in Istanbul, a city that I absolutely love, I would like to leave behind a few thoughts about what could happen here in order to tackle child marriage. Because I was looking at a report that the parliament, your parliament, has a committee on equal opportunity for men and women, and they did a report in 2009 on child marriage. And it's a very interesting report with, I thought, a series of very good recommendations. But unfortunately, there's very little action taking place to implement these recommendations. And I'll refer to a few of these recommendations, but basically I've made my own action list, also based on the visits I paid here earlier this year and what I've learned from the Girls Not Brides partners here in Turkey. So I think, first of all, here in Turkey, what's needed as much as anywhere else in the world is an acknowledgement that child marriage exists and that it is a harmful practice. We need to break the taboo of not talking about this issue. We need to talk about it, and we all have to play a role in this. And I want to again acknowledge the leadership role that the Sabancı Foundation is playing here. But Sabancı can't do it on its own. We all need to do this. Secondly, we need much more data. We need the government to help us in finding much more out what is happening in the communities. Why do girls drop out of school? Is it really because of child marriage? What do boys think, etc.? And then we need a law. The Turkish law right now says that 17 is the age for marriage, although in practice, unfortunately, the law is not getting implemented. So there are, what we understand, many marriages happening far beyond the age of 17. And the National Partnership of Girls Not Brides, that is a platform called No to Child Brides, it's a group of 10th of NGOs here in Turkey, they're pushing now for the law to be changed, and so that 18 will become the minimum age, and that will actually get implemented. We also need a national action plan that needs to then be implemented locally. So, you know, we need to make sure that people get informed about the risks of early pregnancy. They need to get awareness about the importance of education. Within the education system, we need teachers to help to identify what can be done, what can be done. So there needs to be a whole action plan. And of course, we need money for that. And so ideally, I guess, also a little bit of government support for that. And lastly, I'm delighted to see that the Turkish government on the global level is playing an important role in helping to tackle child marriage. It has been supporting proposals for resolutions at the UN that would prohibit child marriage very explicitly, even though it's already prohibited in international conventions. But the Turkish government has also an important role to play in the debate that's currently taking place about what will happen in 2015. You might know that there's something called the Millennium Development Goals, which will expire in 2015. And they're basically about how we're going to eradicate poverty. Now, because child marriage is so much linked to all kinds of drivers of poverty, it would be great if we can make sure that in the next set of development goals, the next development framework, which will start after 2015, that child marriage is in there as an indicator. Because we know that if we make progress on child marriage, we're making progress on education, we're making progress on ending violence, we're making progress on ending maternal death, we're making progress on ending infant death, we're making progress on more equality for men and women. So it would be great to have it in there as an indicator, and I hope that the government will be pushing for that. In conclusion, challenging the impossible. That's what people might think that we're doing when we're trying to end child marriage. But I know that it can be done. I'll never forget a girl who I met when I was in Ethiopia. It was actually a group of girls. They all were married at a very young age. And when I asked them what they wanted for their own children, for their own daughters, their answer was very clear. Two things. First of all, they wanted their girls to go to school and learn the things that they couldn't learn and stay in school until they were 18. And secondly, they said to me, what we want for our daughters is that they can marry who they want, when they want. Now, I'm convinced that if we start creating this change, that actually change can happen really quickly. I am, in fact, convinced it can happen in one generation. Because these girls, if they get the opportunity, they will make sure that their girls will never ever be child brides. So it might seem impossible, but I'm convinced that we can do it in one generation. But it requires all of us to work together. And I hope we'll become partners in this effort. Thank you.
Evet. Bir yandan Mabel Van Oranje'nin konuşmasını dinlerken bir yandan da buradaki yazıya dikkat ediyordum. İmkansızla başladı sevgili Mabel konuşmasına. Bundan bir süre önce komünizmin yıkılacağını, Avrupa'da küçük küçük devletlerin olacağını söyleselerdi, Berlin Duvarı'nın yıkılacağını söyleselerdi kimse inanmazdı. Ya da geçtiğimiz gün kaybettiğimiz Nelson Mandela'nın hapisten çıkacağını söyleselerdi kimse inanmazdı dedi. Ama şimdi imkansız imkanlı hale gelmiş durumda. Bunlar var oldu ve bunları gördük dedi. Sadece olayın nedenini, sadece Türkiye'de değil, dünyada da var olan bu zor ve çözümü de zor olacak konunun nedenini değil, aynı zamanda çözümlerini de bizlerle paylaştığı sevgili Mabel Van Oranje. Tekrar teşekkür ediyoruz kendisine. İmkansızı imkanlı hale getirebiliriz dedi ya, işte şimdi bir konuğumuz daha var. O da imkansız gibi gözükeni gerçekleştirebilmiş, imkanlı hale getirebilmiş bir konuk. Diğer konuğumuz Doktor Tererai Trent. Program ve politika değerlendirme alanında 18 yılı aşkın uluslararası tecrübesiyle kıdemli danışman olarak çalışıyor kendisi. Tererai 5 farklı kıtada Hayfer International gibi küresel insani yardım kuruluşlarında görev yapıyor. Yoksullukla mücadelede en önemli çıkış yolunun eğitim olduğuna inanan Trent, Zimbabwe'den Amerika'ya uzanan hayat hikayesini de tüm dünyadaki insanlarla paylaşıyor. Tererai Trent, çocuklarına daha iyi bir gelecek sunabilmek ve benzer durumda olan kadınlara yardım edebilmek için lisans, yüksek lisans ve doktorayı kendine hedef edinmiş. Bu hedefe ulaşmak için de her türlü zorluğa göğüs germiş bir isim. 25 yıl boyunca programında 30 binden fazla konuk ağırlayan Oprah Winfrey, hepimiz biliyoruz, bizim de mesleğimizin duayeni, ulaşılması zor noktası olarak kabul edilen Oprah Winfrey, tüm zamanların en favori konuğu ilan etmiş Dr. Tererai Trent'i. Neden? Çünkü imkansızı imkanlı hale getirdiği için. Değerli konuklar, Dr. Tererai Trent bizlerle. Welcome, such an inspiring story.
Our common humanity and responsibility to each other is what ignites this world. It flows from our ability to connect, learn, and inspire each other. On this earth, we have a purpose, and it's how we embrace our connectedness. That's what helps to influence and trigger the purpose that we have. As we mourn Nelson Mandela, I am reminded by his words in his autobiography where he stated, "It is only through education that the daughter of a peasant becomes a doctor. The son of a mine worker becomes the head of a mine. The child of a farm worker becomes the president of a great nation." As you listen to my story, one might assume this story is only about Tererai. As the princess well said, it is everybody's story. It is not only about me. It is not only about Tererai. My story is a story that is happening in the world. Unfortunately, it's a story that is representing the realities of our world. It is a story of many girls, a story of many women, a story of many individuals who are seeking freedom, seeking education, seeking meaning, seeking leadership, and failing because the system is not conducive enough for women and girls to thrive. There is no political will. The powers to be ignores these disparities. It is a story of gender inequities, a story of violation of human rights. As Hillary Clinton once said, women's rights are human rights. But it is also a story of hope, a story of achieving dreams, a story of keeping dreams alive, a story that justifies why Sabansi Foundation should continue to empower women and girls, should continue to stand for those policies that will change the girls' rights, should continue to forge and bring other organizations together and say, these girls are our children. We have to make a difference. Today, as I speak, there are almost 800 individuals in the world who cannot read and write. The majority of illiterate people are girls and women. Unfortunately, they comprise three quarters. While South Asia has the highest number of people who cannot read and write, followed by Sub-Saharan Africa, unfortunately in Africa, we begin to see the effects of this disparity by the manner in which girls and women are infected by HIV and AIDS. As you all know that globally there are 34 million people living with HIV and AIDS. Of that 34 million, 23 million are from Africa. And what is said about that 23 million, 60% of the infections are amongst women and girls, with almost 75% of the infections amongst girls ages 13 to 19. Why? Do you really think that girls and women in Africa, they are promiscuous? No, I say no. I think there is more sex in Hollywood than any other place that I know of, but we don't have those numbers of infection. It's a story that tells me that the girls and women are being denied education, and yet it's such a fundamental right. Girls are being forced to marry early, and yet data tells us that when girls remain in school and are given a chance to have an education, their chances of infection from HIV and AIDS are greatly reduced. Also, we know that we have about 7 billion population. This explosion will continue to rise, but if we place education in the hands of girls, in the hands of women, oh my dear gosh, the numbers will be reduced. Every girl, every child, their rights are human rights. Thank you.
Sarah Rai, please stay with us for our next session. Please have a seat. Evet, ben özel değilim, ben farklı değilim dedi ama inanılmaz bir hikaye, inanılmaz ilham verici bir hikaye değil mi? Gerçekten insanın tüyleri diken diken oluyor. Gerçekten insan gözyaşlarını zor zapt ediyor. Please, I would like to invite you once again to our stage, Mabel, for our next session. Please have a seat. Efendim, şimdi karşılıklı sohbet edeceğiz sevgili Mabel ve Tere Rai ile. Bundan sonraki sohbetimiz İngilizce olacak. Dilerseniz kulaklıklarınızla Türkçe takip edebilirsiniz. Wow, it was great. First of all, I would like to say we are honored and excited to have you here at Sabancı Center. Is this your first time in here?
Yes, it's my
This is your first time, but you said you love Istanbul, so I believe this is your
many times.
Okay, many times. Mabel, can you please tell us a little bit about your work, especially Girls Not Brides organization? Yeah.
So, I used to work for an organization called The Elders. Mm-hmm. Which was created by Nelson Mandela, and it brings together 12 former heads of state, presidents, people like Kofi Annan, Jimmy Carter, Martti Ahtisaari, mm-hmm. Archbishop Tutu, Mary Robinson. You get the idea of what kind of people.
And the elders.
The elders. And Graça Machel is one of them as well. And Nelson mm-hmm. Mandela brought them together because he felt that the world has become like a global village, and yet we do not have village elders that look after the well-being of that global village. And one of the things that the elders wanted to work on was the issue of girls and women equality, because they realized that actually this is one of the big injustices in the 21st century. And it is in a way ridiculous that even in far advanced societies, industrialized societies, women are still playing a secondary role. And they, the way they looked at this is actually by tackling something which, you know, might be very sensitive, namely the role of religion and tradition. Because in principle, there's not one religion that says, we do not believe in the equality of girls and women, and, you know, and you have to marry your girls at a young age. But the reality is that very often it is tradition and it is religion that are perpetuating harmful practices that are hurting the opportunities of girls and women. And so the elders said, let us embrace this. Because, you know, if you or I, not you, embrace these things, we will be accused of what I was mentioning earlier, of being a cultural imperialist and of sticking our business into somebody else's religion or tradition. Mm-hmm. But for people like Archbishop Tutu and Graça Machel and, you know, Kofi Annan and Fernando Henrique Cardoso to stand up and to say something is wrong here and this should be changed and it can be changed, that can really make a huge difference. I'll never forget, for example, President Cardoso, the former president of Brazil. One of the big problems in Latin America is violence against women. Men think it's cool to actually beat up your wife mm-hmm. or your girlfriend or what have you. So when he stands up and he says, you know, it is actually not cool to do that, that has an impact. Anyway, so I was lucky enough at the time to be their CEO, and I worked with them to try to give much more visibility to, in general, this issue of tradition and religion being misused, but then especially this terrible practice of child marriage, because we realize that if you address child marriage, you're addressing so many other issues at the same time. Mm-hmm. And so the way we did it wasn't, as I was saying earlier, you always need to have big vision. So we figured there are two things that the elders are particularly well placed to do. One is to help to start breaking the taboo and to get this issue discussed. So they started doing that in 2010. We're now 3 years down the line. And I think, you know, we're starting to see some progress there. And the other thing is they realized, let's create a network of organizations that actually want to tackle this. This organization called Girls Not Brides. And I'm very proud to say that this initiative, Girls Not Brides, of which I'm now the board chair, that was incubated by the elders, has now grown to be such a strong organization, and it's having its own financial support, et cetera, that actually this week it became an independent organization and stepped out of the elders' organization.
That's good news.
That's very nice. It doesn't mean that the elders are no longer supporting this issue. I mean, Archbishop Tutu himself has made a public commitment many times saying that he will fight the practice of child marriage with the same determination that he's been fighting apartheid. So, you know, some of the elders will definitely stay engaged. But, you know, it's good to see that we're creating more and more momentum. And I'm so incredibly excited that, partially because of the wonderful partnership with the Sabancı Foundation, and because there are a few really amazing NGOs here in Turkey that are working in this field, that we're really seeing momentum happening here.
It's progressing, right? It's progressing.
It is, yeah.
We all say girls not brides, but you were a child bride. You get married when you were 11 years old, right? Like your mother and like your grandmother. What can be done to end this harmful practice, dear Tererai?
I truly believe education is the main pathway out of all these issues. If I look at myself, when my mother said, if you get this education, not only are you defining who you are, but you are also defining every life that comes out of your womb. Meaning, my mother realized there was a point to break this cycle. Mm-hmm. As I get educated myself, I begin to see that tradition and that culture is not good for our girls. it marginalizes and oppresses us. And my own girls, because now they are educated, I have my daughter, she just graduated with a mechanical engineering degree.
Really? Oh.
And I'm looking at her and thinking, dear gosh, if she had not had this education, probably she would end up just like me. So the education truly makes a difference.
Can education solve all the problems?
I think education with good minds can can solve some
good
of the problems.
Good minds and education.
Because we need policymakers who can understand mm-hmm. some of these issues. Mm-hmm. As long as we have people that support us, that believe in education. Because if you're not educated, you cannot advocate for good policies. Mm-hmm. So education becomes the engine. It becomes that thing that transforms nations.
Dear Mabel, we know that you're actively lobbying to get child marriage into the post-2015 development agenda of the United Nations. Yes. Is it progressing?
It's making good progress, but I always get worried when you're making good progress, also the risks of losing what you've gained become bigger and bigger and bigger.
Yeah.
There seems to be agreement. There was this high-level panel that was thinking about the future of the Millennium Development Goals. The mayor of Istanbul was a member. 26 eminent people were members. And they came out with a report, I believe it was in May or June, that identified equality for our girls and women as one of the, what they thought should be a target for the future of the development goals, and very specifically said that ending child marriage should be part of that. And we had lobbied very hard and mm-hmm. done a lot of advocacy work, we meaning these 300 NGOs, and trying to get this on into their report. We were then very happy to see that when the Secretary General of the United Nations issued his report on what he thinks needs to happen with the future of the development goals, mm-hmm. that actually also there, he was making specific reference to ending child marriage. I mean, you have to realize, ending child marriage 3 years ago, you would have a report of 150 pages on, for example, education for girls. There would maybe be one reference to child marriage on like page 78. Mm. So here you have an issue that was neglected, completely neglected, now getting to the core of the debate. But the reality is that there's now a whole process. These two reports are very good, but there's now a whole process of member states, the 193, I think, member states of the UN now having to agree on the future of the development agenda. And that's a process that will take a year and a half, and you know how politics sometimes can go. It gets very dirty, and it becomes like horse trading. Mm. Like, oh, I want this, oh, I'll give you that. Now, I would personally find it absolutely unacceptable if they basically say, we do not care about young girls getting married, so you know what? We're not going to include it. Mm. We're going to neglect the advice that was given to us by the high-level panel and by the Secretary General. But you never know. You just never know, because maybe at some point they will all get in a fight about should we then define the right age of marriage, and then some people might say, well, we think 18 is too old and 16 is better, and you just don't know. And so these things, for me, I think there's an amazing momentum building up, but we didn't win yet, and so we need to keep going, and that's one of the things that we want to focus on in the coming 2 years, of making sure that this will get included. And the reason, I mean, you might think, like, who cares about these high-level discussions and all these UN things? Let me put in very simple terms why it matters that we get this in. There are two reasons. First, the one that I mentioned earlier. If we are serious about getting girls into school, if we are serious about having girls not die in childbirth, if we're serious about ending infant mortality, if we're serious about reducing HIV/AIDS, if we're serious about ending poverty, if we're serious about equality for men and women, we have to tackle child marriage. We cannot longer ignore it. I mean, we're fooling ourselves. And the second reason why it's important to get it in is that ending child marriage is not necessarily a very expensive business. It's not like you have to buy antiretrovirals like you have to do in the case of trying to stop HIV/AIDS. A lot of the community work that we're talking about is time intensive. It requires human resources, but it's not like we need billions. However, if we want money to go to these things, we need to have the issue on the agenda, because this is how cynical the world is. If you're not recognized as a priority, it's very hard to get money flowing. Mm-hmm.
Tererai, you agree?
Huh? Yes, you totally agree. I do.
You went to Oklahoma State University, as you said. At the same time, you were working at 3 jobs, taking care of 5 children, plus a husband. How did you manage all these? Can any woman can do that?
I think yes, we can. We can. Remember, my situation was very difficult, and I had buried my dreams, mm-hmm. and I wanted to achieve them. So I also wanted to make a difference so that my own girls don't have to go through what I did go through. So I had this motivation in me that no matter what it takes, mm-hmm. I was going to do it. I also realized that where I was coming from, it was bad than the deal that I had in front of me. So who was I to say, well, this is so difficult for me? Mm-hmm. And I could see the light at the end of the tunnel. I could see that if I just achieve my dreams, I would have it. In a million years, who would have guessed that I would be sitting here with you guys? It is the power of education.
Dear guest, let's write down our dreams and let's bury the paper. Let's motivate ourselves.
But I don't think it's a question of burying the dreams, but I think it's a question of being intentional with what you want. My mother mm-hmm. advised me to bury because she realized I needed something to believe in. I was so mm-hmm. overwhelmed with my challenges. Look at most non-profit organizations and business entities. They write strategic plans.
And
they
write strategy, yes.
strategies, and they write objectives, and they are guided by those. So my mother knew that I needed something to guide me. It's not in the bearing, but it's in the actual writing and maintaining that vision.
And your guidance was that paper, right? You
yes.
always remember that.
Yes, yes.
That's quite a story. Mabel, you said in your speech, this subject is invisible. Do you think it's becoming visible?
Is it? But it's going very slowly. And no, it's not actually going
slowly.
Why is it so
slow?
I think it's actually going quite quick. But it's enormous. So there's so much that needs to be done. And I think we also need to watch out that one thing is for an issue to become visible and that people start writing reports and resolutions, and mm-hmm. which is all very nice, but ultimately we know that doesn't change. And we need all that visibility and all these resolutions and reports and commitments and big political talk to trigger the change that needs to happen on the ground. And so what I feel and what is actually really exciting, and I think I would not have thought it would happen only 3 years or so after the elders started working on this issue. I think we're now getting to the stage where we need to see much more work happening on the ground, mm-hmm. in the communities. Mm-hmm. And that is becoming possible because there are more groups interested in working on the ground. It's becoming possible because we see increasingly donors, whether it's foundations, but also government donors, willing to put money behind this. Mm-hmm. And so the next big challenge is, apart from keeping that momentum going and growing globally, will be to actually be able to point out that change is possible on a meaningful scale. We know from a lot of pilot work that's happening that it can work, mm-hmm. but now we need to see that grow so that you... Because you will always be skeptics. I mean, you must have had so many people in your life who said, that's impossible, you know, stop, give up. And there will always be people, oh, you know, it can't be done. And so we need to make sure that in a few years' time, let's say in 5 years' time, we can point to a few countries and say, look at that place. Something really meaningful is happening. So for example, in Zambia, there's now, there's an amazing minister who deals with traditional and religious leaders. and who's working together with the wife of the president and a few others. They have made this national plan, which they're trying to implement. Now, you know, let's see how that works, and let's then make an assessment. But, you know, I think also there are always you know, bumps in the road, and there are always people who tell you it can't be done. But I am convinced, and when you have a plan, a strategic plan that makes sense, and when you have a vision that is that is a vision of a more right, a more just, a more equitable world, and you have a sound plan, and you're willing to change course if things don't go exactly as you thought, that it is doable. And I've personally committed a long, long time ago myself to working on issues where I know there are people who want to create real change. And I see it as my personal commitment to try to help all these change makers, very important ones, very famous ones, and very ordinary and therefore extraordinary ones, the girls in the village, the teachers, the religious leaders, to work with anybody who is trying to create real change, to try to do whatever I can to help to empower them to create that vision.
Tererai, you were denied an education because you were a girl when you were a little, when you were a kid. How did it affect you?
I think it affected me because I wanted that education. As a girl, I can relate to those girls that are being married young, girls that are being denied. It affects your self-esteem. You always feel that you are lesser than others. It affected me in just day-to-day life. I felt marginalized. But I was very fortunate because I had a very strong mother. My mother would always say, you are bigger, you are a champion.
How about your father? We understood that your mother was a very strong... Is she still alive, by the way?
My mother died recently.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. How about your father? You know, what was your father saying?
You know, I come from a patriarchal society. And patriarchal men, they have their own way of thinking. But you know, I personally don't want to demonize men or demonize my father. I always say it's because of ignorance. If my father and the men in my village had been born in Istanbul and had gone to school, I doubt very much they would have behaved that way. It's ignorance. But when we bring education to these communities, we change generations. So I know at times we feel, you know, it is the tradition, but remember, whoever authored the tradition, mostly they were men and mostly they were ignorant. But when we bring education and enlightenment, we tend to change the narratives. And I say that. Look at all the countries that were colonized by whoever. One thing that was denied was education in most cases, because later on, the colonizers realized that when you educate, you empower. When you empower, you make individuals reach their maximum potential. So education is the key to open up minds, to change the narratives.
Can I add on to that?
Sure.
Because there is no doubt that education is absolutely crucial and the number one thing that we need to work on. But what I find very interesting when you look at how social change happens, there's something strange about what does it take for us as a community to collectively decide that we don't want to do child marriage anymore. We need to get agreement that it is harmful for all of us collectively. So we need to get that information. But what happens is that at some point, when you collectively agree that something is not good and that you want to end it, it really switches overnight. And that kind of that social change on how behavior, on how traditions become unacceptable, we know very little about it. Think, for example, about something like, I'm maybe not in the right country to say that, because I know that people still do quite a bit of smoking here, but like, you know, growing up in the Netherlands, everybody would smoke. not everybody, but you know, like, it was completely socially accepted. And in the span of just a few years, smoking became unacceptable. I mean, people who smoke, people now look at them like, ooh. Mm-hmm. You see it, for example, with the whole issue of gay marriage, which and lesbian marriage, mm-hmm. which in most countries 30 years ago, I mean, everywhere in the world, it was seen as a taboo. And you now see countries that completely, I mean,
changing, right? Changing. Everything is changing. Mm-hmm.
And so how do social norms change? I mean, mm-hmm. I mentioned foot binding earlier. I mean, here is something that was done for hundreds and hundreds of years, and it basically takes 20, 30 years to change it. So at some point, something switched in people's head, mm-hmm. and it created a social pressure that now you're not longer an outsider if you do not want to marry your girl at a young age. Now you're the outsider if you do want to marry her at a young age. And so what we need to figure out is how do we get that snowball rolling? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because ultimately, reaching out to all these 14 million girls every year, one by one, is going to be impossible. Mm-hmm. But we do know that if we reach out to a critical mass, that snowball is going to roll and that it's going to happen almost automatically. Mm-hmm. And I would be very, very interested as we engage in this process that we learn much more about mm-hmm. this. Because there are other big challenges in the world, whether you think about climate change, whether you think, mm-hmm. I mean, think about demographic
violence,
you know, that also will require at some point, some will need big political solutions, but many of them will need behavior change, will demand that we as humanity change the way we look at challenges. And so we need to learn from that, I believe. And and so I'm very keen to see how that happens.
And I think when I say education, I don't necessarily mean formal education. The fact that I can go back to my own community, a community where we have probably 97% illiteracy. But then they see me as a role model. They see the changes that I can bring. It's a learning in its own mm-hmm. form. When mm-hmm. we received the 1.5 million from Oprah Winfrey Show, there was a learning curve in the community. They say to themselves, there's something good about this. How can we receive this 1.5 million? It means they see potential in us. The community themselves, they started molding bricks, hand molding bricks, 500,000 bricks that they molded for the school. Mm-hmm. That's a transformation at the community level. It didn't take degrees to do that. But they can now see and relate to me as a role model in their own community and say, you know what, our girls can also be just like Tererai. They can also bring education. They can also change. Remember, my father used to point to the boys and say, these are the breadwinners of tomorrow. We need to educate them. My mother would always say, pointing to the girls, these are the breadwinners of tomorrow. Look at what Tererai has done. We need to educate. So those are some of the social changes that we can see at community level, but they have to see something to believe that, yes, we can do it.
Mm-hmm. Actually, in your speech, you said individuals cannot make big changes. We have to unite. Mm-hmm. But you too can make change because your philanthropy personality and your role model character can make change. Am I right?
But, you know, when I say role model, I'm not saying, yes, I am the role model.
But you are.
But I think the community, they've never seen women coming back and change the narratives. They've always seen men doing that. Mm-hmm. But I also realize that alone, I cannot make the change. In Africa, we have a saying, it takes more than two thumbs to crush the head lice, because we don't have pesticides for the head lice. So you find all the women, they are crushing, and it takes two. So it takes all of us in the community to make that change. Mm-hmm. But one person can have the vision and say, you know what, I'm part of you. Mm-hmm. We can do this together.
We can do this all together.
Yeah.
We can do this all together.
Yeah.
Princess Mabel, you are a Dutch, you're part of Dutch royal family. Actually, you're a princess. How has your royal identity affect your work or helps?
Well, you know, I got engaged in work to make the world a better place, a more just place, to promote human rights, to promote democracy, a long time before I met my husband. And I'll admit here that one of my big worries was that if I would stay with him, could I still continue to do my work? Because I really feel that I'm so incredibly grateful for that I was lucky being born where I was born in a wealthy country where there's a lot of respect for human rights, freedom of expression, etc. I mean, imagine I had been born in your village, and if my mother had not encouraged me to write down my dreams, I might not be sitting here today. Mm-hmm. And so I've always felt that I should give back, and that in a way, to make my life meaningful, I should do what I can to help make other people more prosperous and the world a better place. So as I was saying, I was actually a little worried when I found out that I really loved my husband. Would you know, becoming part of his family in any way affect my ability to work? And luckily, it hasn't done so. It has sometimes made things easier, but it's also sometimes made things more complicated. Mm-hmm. And
so how complicated, for example?
I don't know. People sometimes look at you in a different way. But, you know, it's. So, you know, people are not always, since they sometimes wonder, oh, is she doing that because she's a princess or because she's a, you know, there's all, you know how it is.
I mean, yeah.
It's like people have prejudices. People think, oh, she is a princess, so she must be like
prejudice,
this or that.
Prejudice, yeah.
You know,
but the beauty is you have taken this power that you have for the greater good.
Yes.
You are using the platform to reach out to issues that are so fundamentally and so important for this world. Otherwise, you could have just stayed in your own castle and do nothing about it.
No, I never would have done that. I was already so busy with all this stuff.
that's why I'm saying I think it's important that you're doing that.
And you know what? Whatever happens, I am committed to this issue. Mm-hmm. And, you know,
thank you for doing that.
Thank you for doing that.
And that's what I think we can all do in our own way.
You're so, I mean, I've known you through the cameras and photographs for so many years, but when I first met you, I was like, oh my God, she's so calm, she's so down to earth. It's a great honor to meet you and to have you here. Of course, you too, Tere Rai. It was a pleasure to have you both in at Sabancı Center.
Thank you.
Now thank our you next session, us. Question and answers, Q&A session. Are you ready for
absolutely
the questions?
So we need to hear
would you like to put your headphones?
Okay.
Okay. Let's see.
Efendim, şimdi soru cevap zamanımıza geldi. Gördüğünüz gibi burada iki çok önemli, çok değerli ismi ağırlıyoruz. 7. filantropi seminerimizde Sabancı Vakfı'nın düzenlediği ve artık geleneksel hale gelen bu seneki konuklarımız çok önemli bir lider ve hayatıyla değişim yapan, hayatıyla ilham veren ve eğitimin önemini bize kanıtlayan Dr. Tere Rai Trent. Buyurunuz, sorularınızı bekliyorlar efendim.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
I actually have a question for Tere Rai. I was just wondering, you made such an immense change in your community. Has that had any reflection on a higher level? What with the government and the policy change? Have you had any conversation with government officials? I was just wondering, you know, if that change can spread out to other parts of the country and not just stay within your community. It's remarkable. So once you have that, you know, momentum, why not use it?
Thank you. Thank you for that. And I have consciously and deliberately used that platform to reach out to the government. Remember, these schools are public schools. These are government schools. And the schools have now become more like the model for the whole country. I get invited, I work hand in hand with the Minister of Minister of Education, and we develop curriculums together. I work with the local NGO, Save the Children. So we are really having so much influence within the government because they have seen what we can do, they have seen the results. Remember, we got this funding in 2011, and within 3 years, we have managed to build a school. We have managed to train 125 teachers. When we took over in this school, we had about, we started with 6% pass rate, and today we have about 45% pass rate. And that's remarkable in a rural area. So the government is saying, what is it that we have? What magic can we also use? So I'm working with the government to make sure that we can spread all over the country and make these necessary changes.
Başka sorusu olan var mı? Oo, ne güzel sorularımız var bol bol. İsterseniz şuradan başlayalım. Kendinizi de tanıtır mısınız lütfen? İsminizi de alalım sorularınızı almadan önce.
Hello, Itır Erhard. I work on human rights issues and gender issues, member of Bilgi University. So whenever we do work with against child marriage, you know, we really focus on women, right? So we try to educate them, we try to tell them this is wrong, you know, this is not healthy. So we have, even in small communities, we go work with women. But what about men? You know, I was thinking like men who do marry these women also need to be educated and need to be shown that this is not healthy, this is not good for the community. So I was thinking like men who did actually marry child brides and you know, they should come up and say, I didn't do something right, like I shouldn't have done it, and these are the consequences we suffered. What do you think about that, like men's involvement in this project? Thank
well,
you.
Well, we need to educate both, I guess, men please, as well, you. Huh? What I, would you like I to say about that?
I completely agree, completely, because in many instances, it's actually very difficult for the girls or even for their mothers to stand up and say, we don't want this. And we need to reach out to the men. And that can be sensitive, obviously. But I think we need to especially reach out to two or three different groups of men. One is the community leaders, religious leaders, any other men of influence in a community, and help them understand that this is not a good thing to do. Because they will obviously have a huge influence over the community. Secondly, I think we need to reach out to fathers. Mm. Not so much to say, look, the fact that you married your wife when she was young, you were wrong. No, often these boys didn't really have, or these young men didn't really have a big choice either. But we need them to realize what it would mean if they married their daughters young, so that they realize this is not a good thing to do for my daughters. And thirdly, there are examples of where when you reach out to boys who are the age of potentially getting married, that they might, I mean, I've met kids, for example, in India who went to their boys who convinced their parents that it was not a good idea for them to marry girls who were 11, 12, 13 years old. So I'm convinced that if we just work on women and girls, it's not gonna be enough. And it is very important, but it needs to be complemented by working on men. Mm. And that's also why it's so important that we get male role models. I mean, I had quite a few interesting conversations with the mayor here about it, and I don't know if that ever resulted in him publicly speaking out about child marriage, but that would of course be really interesting if, you know, if eminent individuals, I mean, my dream, for example, is that we get Bollywood stars, you know, and famous Indian cricket players and Nollywood stars from Nigeria to join the elders and other eminent persons who are speaking out about this, because they're such enormous role models for their own community. So I know you guys have a few good soccer stars. I mean, wouldn't it be cool if we get some of them to speak out? So that's, I think, the way we need to look at well.
It's a good idea, huh? We have such a good soccer players.
That's what I hear. So.
Like every other country. Any other question?
Bedensel Engelliler Derneği'nden Güler Kayahan. Ben bir soru sormak değil de bir ekleme yapmak istiyorum. Eğitimin neden önemli olduğunu hepimiz biliyoruz. Bu engelliler açısından da böyle. Şöyle bir şey yaşadım. Bir takım kurumlar, biliyorsunuz 50 kişiden fazla eleman çalıştıran kurumlar engelli çalıştırmak durumunda yasal olarak.
Evet.
Bize bu konuda bir takım istemler geldiğinde bazen onların koşullarına uyan engelli bulmakta zorlanıyoruz. Çünkü eğitim alamıyorlar yeterince. Alabilselerdi bütün yaşamları değişecekti. Üretken olacaklardı, topluma daha etkin katılacaklardı. Bu konuyu da ayrıca belirtmek istiyorum.
Çok
eğitimin önemi
ediyoruz.
Konusunda.
Çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Yani teşekkür eğitim ederim. Sadece çocuk gelinlerin artık çocuk gelin olmamaları için değil, aslında toplumun her alanına sirayet
kesinlikle
etmeli.
Kesinlikle çok önemli. Hele de engelliler gibi yaşamları engellenmiş ve zorlu giden gruplar için. Çok teşekkür ediyorum.
Biz teşekkür ediyoruz efendim.
You know, it's really interesting.
Aha.
Because I was actually last week talking about this. Because it's another big invisible challenge that we're
yes.
not dealing with. Mm-hmm. I believe that, I might have the figures wrong, so forgive me. But I believe that one out of every 10 or 8 people, 8 people in the world has a disability, physical mm-hmm. or mental. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, we often don't see them, and like you say, they're not integrated in the workforce. And even when they get educated, they often are discriminated against. Mm-hmm. So I was talking with my friend who has a company in the Netherlands. It's a social good company, a social enterprise, and they're selling solar panels because in the Netherlands we sometimes have sun, not so often, but you know, they're selling solar panels and whatever. Now she has employed a whole bunch of people who are deaf, and guess what? Because they can do sign language, they now have all these deaf people in the Netherlands who are, you know, kind of. Informed about this solar panel business through these guys who work there who are deaf. Mm-hmm. So they now have ton loads of new customers who just love them because they're employing deaf people and because these deaf people have been making advertisement. Mm-hmm. So there is often a win as well. We just need to be much more creative in the way we look at things.
And we
But
have
again,
to
this
think.
Is something where we might think it's impossible. Mm-hmm. You know what? Mm-hmm. No, if a bunch of us kind of find the energy and the momentum, I don't have time right now, I'm focusing on child marriage. But maybe later in my life, I'll come and help you.
Başka sorusu olan var mı? Buyurunuz efendim. Sonra size söz vereceğiz.
I am Sondan Durukanoğlu Fey, Vice President of Sabancı University, and I'm also a physics professor. I have a personal question to Terira. As a professor, I talked to several high school students, and they don't know the meaning of doing PhD. My personal question to you. As a person with no high school diploma, how I really wonder how the idea of doing PhD came to your mind.
How did the idea of doing a PhD come into your mind?
Without having a PhD,
there's so many students who do not even know what a PhD is.
When you were a kid, how did you?
So you know, Zimbabwe gained independence. It's the last country to gain independence in Africa. You know that?
Yeah.
So here's what was happening. When we gained independence, Zimbabwe became the darling of the world because of what Mugabe did with reconciliation. And all of a sudden, our rural communities, we had people from all over the world coming into Zimbabwe because we have good safaris, we had all these good things. And you start hearing, you start seeing women, educated women, holding papers. You know, they are coming to do research. And as they are opening them, wearing their glasses, and I'm thinking, I just want to be just like that woman. I just want to be just like that woman. Seriously, I used to think, wearing glasses, I used to equate wearing glasses with education, and would hear PhD. I'm doing my research in PhD. So that alone really made me want, well, I can be just like that, just like her.
But you don't use glasses?
No, now I realize, no, it's blindness.
I hope you don't need it. I hope you don't need it. It was just a joke. Beyefendi vardı. Bir beyefendiden de sorusunu alalım.
Teşekkür ederim. Ben Ufuk Polat. Peki bu misafirlerimize sorabilir miyim lütfen, rica ediyorum. Bu dünya liderleri, ülke liderleri bu konular hakkında ne düşünüyorlar? Hiç bir sordunuz mu?
Evet. Prenses Mabel'a mı soruyorsunuz?
Her ikisine de.
Peki. Dünya liderleri bu konu hakkında ne düşünüyor diye soruyorsunuz.
Maybe I will talk a bit about child marriage and you'll talk a bit about education. Mm-hmm. So I think it's fair to say that 3 years ago there was not any world leader talking about this issue about child marriage. And now we see increasingly world leaders who talk about it partially because they're encouraged by these two reports that I mentioned from the high-level panel and from the Secretary General. But we also see people, individuals, who becoming champions. For example, the foreign minister in Canada really cares about this. And of course, whenever it's a man who starts embracing a women's issue, I'm always happy when somebody becomes a champion for the cause. But when it's a man, it's even better, you know? It's kind of, it just helps so much. So you see that the Dutch government is now behind this. The British government, I was on a panel 2 days ago with the British development minister. They feel very strongly about the need to tackle harmful practices that hurt women and girls. Mm-hmm. Hillary Clinton is a great mm-hmm. champion. But what is very important is that we need leaders not just from the West. Mm-hmm. We need mm-hmm. leaders from the South, so to say, as mm-hmm. well. Because ultimately, and that's why where the role of the elders is so important, but that's also, you know, what I was mentioning, what's happening in Zambia is so useful. And we see in other governments that are now starting to care. Mm-hmm. And that's also one of the reasons why I so much hope that the leadership we see in this country on an NGO and a foundation level, and that we see globally the Turkish government pushing some of these resolutions they want to implement. For Turkey to play an even more prominent role globally would be fantastic, because this is an issue in your country as well. So, mm-hmm. I mean, Turkey could only do that if the government starts tackling the practice here at home as well. Otherwise, you're not credible globally. But because you see, it's, for example, very interesting. When we had a meeting earlier this year here, and we brought together people working to end child marriage from many countries, I was fascinated by what the Pakistani guests were telling. Because apparently in Pakistan, Turkish soap operas are really popular and are incredibly credible. I mean, apparently much better quality than their own soap operas. They don't watch Indian soap operas for obvious reasons, etc. Anyway, so apparently you guys have a soap opera that is a lot about child marriage. Mm-hmm. And that soap opera is super influential in Pakistan. And therefore, as a consequence, the whole issue of child marriage has become much less of a taboo and much easier to discuss thanks to Turkish soap operas. Now, so, you know, yes, we need leaders, but we also need these kinds of things. So
I wonder which one was that.
I must say, I'm not an expert on Turkish soap opera, at least not yet.
I think global leaders doing their work, I truly believe that they want to see changes around gender issues, around education. Look at all the resolutions that have been made by the United Nations. And I think one of the points that you raised is when we talk about these issues, which leaders are on the forefront on these issues? Like, for instance, if you talk about developing countries, let's make sure that we energize, we inspire the local leaders. Because if a local person stands in front and say, we need to make these changes, people can relate to that person. But when a Western person comes in, it almost seems like a top-down approach, and people are just tired of that. So our role as Western countries, probably, as leaders, is to make sure that we energize the local leaders, we give them enough education, we support them with resources, with knowledge, with everything that we can, so that they can be the ones standing in front and be seen as the role models. I think it will work much better than us going in and tell people, you are making mistakes, this is what you are doing, we don't need to see this, you need to change your policies. I think it won't make anything move forward.
I agree with her.
And this is a question for Tererai, and this question is inspired by what Mabel was talking about, and it is also based on my own experiences collecting stories in the Aegean region of Turkey. I'm an MFA student in creative writing, and I'm traveling around in villages in the Aegean region. And my aim was to collect only folk tales, fairy tales, just that. And along the way, I came to realize that those stories come with real life stories and never really apart. So along the way, my project kind of transformed into something else. So now it is both about fairy tales and folk tales, and also about real life stories. And I'm working with Turkish American Society and Columbia University. And here is my question. People like to see role models, like going out there, get education and come back, or just to see that this can happen. And by the way, it is so true that child marriage or only religious marriage exists in the Western Turkey too. And it is so sad to see. But sometimes when people see that, some people come back to their own community to be role models or just to show that this can happen, this is possible. People sometimes think that this is kind of giving false hopes to them. They tend to think that this is not going to happen for them. And I mean, this at least shows that they want to change. But as Mabel says, sometimes it is so difficult to create that change. And sometimes people tend to see those people as a threat rather than giving hope. So did that ever happen to you? Like, were you ever regarded as a threat? Like, oh, she's going to change the way we do things around here, kind of attitude? I was just wondering. Thank you.
You know, oh goodness, that's an important question. I do not think that my community saw me as a threat, because I grew up in that community. I was born in that community. They knew my struggles. So when I came back, I didn't come with hope. I came with the real deal. I came with education. It wasn't blah, blah, blah talk. Yeah, we are going to have education. I came with the package. Here is education. If you want your kids to be just like me, this is it. And the community accepted that by molding bricks, because they realized if this Tererai thing can do it, our own girls truly, truly, they can come back and make us proud. They can be working. They can be the one providing for us, and they can be the one educating their own children. So for me, it wasn't like, you know, just talk about, we need to educate, we need to do. I came back with 1.5 million. And later on, which was never shown in the video, I was in South Africa with Oprah. I was speaking at her school. And, you know, she has a school in South Africa, and I was, after I spoke, you know, we had our dinner, and I was about to go home, and she said, Tererai, I have something that I want to give you. This time, there are no cameras, there's nothing. Here's 500,000 for building a library in your community. Now we have a library in our rural community, never seen in any rural place in my country. So those changes, when people see that we are promoting reading, we are promoting literacy boost within the country, it energizes parents to appreciate that, you know, if your child is able to read and write, you know, you are proud. So I guess, I hope I'm answering your question. But they've never seen it as a threat.
Başka sorusu olan? Son sorumuzu. Son sorumuzu da sizden alalım.
Merhaba. Ben rol model konusunda bir katkıda bulunmak istiyorum. Şöyle ki, ben bir trafik kazasından sonra infaz oldum. Ve 94 senesinden beri tekerlekli sandalye kullanıyorum. Rol model dediğiniz yaşamın her anlamında, her alanında çok önemli bir durum bu. Çünkü başınıza ne gelirse gelsin, işte gerek tahsil konusunda, gerek evlilik konusunda, gerek boşanma, gerek bir benim gibi engellik durumunda bu işi bilen ya da bu işi başarmış kişileri tanışmak sizin için yaşamınızı çok kolaylaştırıyor. Ben kaza geçirdiğim zaman Türkiye'de sadece ben kaza geçirdim ve felç olduğumu düşünüyordum. Çünkü ailemde ve çevremde hiç engelli yoktu. Bu benim için çok zor bir durumdu. Daha sonra hanımefendinin yaptığı gibi ya bu işi başkalarına da rol, yani iyi bir rol model olaraktan insanlarla tanışıp bu yaşamı onlara öğretip onlarla yoldaş olup ve onların yoluna ilerlemek çok önemli olduğunu biliyorum artık. Ve aynı zamanda ben Türkiye Omurilik Felçlilerden Yönetim Kurulu üyesiyim. Bizim Tudors denen bir projemiz var. İspanya'yla ortaklaşa yürüttüğümüz. Ve biz de şimdi bu rol model akran danışmanlığını hastanelere gidip ya da ev ziyaretlere gidip ya da bize ulaşan kişilere yaşamımızdaki kolaylıkları ve doğru yolu gösterip yaşamlarını daha iyi bir şekilde sürdürmeni sağlamaya çalışıyoruz. Teşekkür ederim.
Çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Sağ olunuz. Zannedersem bitti zamanımız. Biliyorum çok sorumuz var. Sormak istediğimiz çok şey var. 8. filantropi seminerimize inşallah. Değil mi Zerrin Hanım? Buyurun Dilek Hanım.
Speakerlara, I would like to thank both of the speakers for giving such a good speech about, you know, women and girls, but not brides, and educational issues. I was so impressed by watching the film.
Oprah show. The,
exactly. I mean, I couldn't stop crying.
I saw
not
that.
Because of the unhappiness and because of negativeness. I was crying because of positiveness. How, you know, the effort, the ambition, the motivation you have to make a difference. That was why I was crying. Congratulations for this very good seminar.
Thank you.
We need people, we need more people like you. We need in on the government level, on the non-profit level, on the, you know, like, industrial level, we need a lot of examples like you to make this world go better. Thank you.
It was an incredible seminar, right? It was an incredible seminar. Thank you for joining us. Danke well, Princess. And thank you. Thank you. How do you say in Shona language? Thank you.
Tatena.
Tatena. Tatena and danke well. Thank you for joining us. Efendim gerçekten ilham veren iki konukla birlikteydik. Filantropi seminerimizin 7.sinin sonuna geldik. 8. filantropi seminerimizde tekrar sizlerle beraber olmak dileğiyle. Umarım gerçekten içinize dokunmuştur diye düşünüyorum ki öyle de görüyorum. Görüşmek üzere diyorum. Hoşça kalın.